Hi, Ellie.
Hi, Georgiana. How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. This is Better Now, Living Mindfully. It's a conversation between two friends that explores a mindful approach to life. And today we are going to be talking about mindful eating. So I was just wondering, Georgiana, I feel like I'm eating differently now because my whole routine has changed. I don't know if that's happening to you, but
Oh yeah.
yeah, it's so
I
hard. Every time I get hungry, I just go and get it. And I think I'm not even hungry. I'm just maybe bored or something.
Well, exactly. I have a relationship with food. I think a lot of people do have a relationship that has evolved over the years with eating too much, eating too little, dieting, trying to maintain a weight, and this has changed the relationship to food that I have because I'm home all the time. And being home means that I am close to the refrigerator. I can eat while I'm working more so than if I were going into a workplace where you just can't eat all day long. The possibility of eating all day long exists. So it changes the dynamic between me and food because food is always saying, "Oh, I'm so yummy. I am here." And I'm always saying, "No, I just had something to eat like an hour ago. I'm not hungry." But it means that what I have to do is become more aware of what I'm eating, when I'm eating, and pay attention. It's that mindfulness again that gets brought into this relationship that I'm having with food. Choices start happening. My intention during the day is to, of course, is my work to serve others, but also an intention to serve myself in the most healthy ways that I can through diet and exercise, nutritious eating, and kindness to myself and kindness to others. But this food takes a different relationship that for me has to start back when I'm doing my shopping list. Because if I'm doing a shopping list and I'm putting chips, just like if I were going into the grocery store and shopping, and well, we used to have a luxury of going in and shopping around, and I'd pick up a bag of chips and I'd start eating them. I wouldn't even know that I have this chips or that I'm eating them, but all of a sudden, this chips, and of course, I'm going to pay for them, but it's that unknowing, automatic eating that I have to become more conscious of every day.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying, and I feel like there's an impulsivity. There's an impulse for me to just grab something, and I've made it really easy because I've taken my nuts and I put them on the table next to my computer. So it's like, between every couple of sentences that I'm typing, oh, I'm just going to reach over there and get a couple of nuts, you know? And it kind of works in that way of putting things out there. Like if I have water, like a bottle of water, not a bottle, but I have this glass jar of water in every room. It helps out. So then I'm able to get a glass of water wherever I'm at, or bring my water canteen wherever I'm at. And that kind of works for me. But it also has an adverse effect so that if I'm putting food wherever I'm at, then I go and grab it based on my impulse. And the impulsivity is so different than what you're talking about, which is being really mindful of when I'm eating and how I'm eating. And you have such a wonderful way of eating mindfully. I was wondering if you could share that with our listeners.
Well, I think it begins in recognizing what food is for us and for me. Food is nourishment, but it's also the abundance that we have in our lives. Food is the sensual quality of the plum with its color and its juiciness. Just even thinking about it makes my mouth start watering for a big juicy plum that are just starting to be in season. Developing a mindfulness around food has helped me so much to be present with the food I'm eating. And that's really what my relationship is now with food and with many things in my life. It's being now present with what I'm eating, which means it's a sensuous activity. I recognize the food. I recognize the color. It may be very, have an aroma to it. I know, Ellie, that you are a great cook and you make these beautiful presentations of food. And I like to look at the presentation of the food and it starts there. This present moment is with the presentation of the food. Oh my goodness, this food looks so beautiful. And just taking that pause and that breath of appreciation and gratitude, it goes to gratitude of thank you for this wonderful plate of nourishment and beauty in my life.
And there is a slowness about that, taking it in, that I've seen you eat with, that it's not like a gobbling up, or you know when you kind of like scoot down to where the plate is and there's less space between your mouth and the plate.
Yes.
You know, taking that like fork, like a shovel, and just like shoveling in there because like, yeah, oh my god, this tastes so good, I just want to like devour it. No, there is like this like slowness about how you approach the food. It's like a dance with it. You just like feast on it visually.
Yeah.
And you really are,
it's
just
smell.
And I don't want to use the word mindful. Yes. It's just
the smell, the taste, the aroma, the visual of it. And how many of us, me included, have done that at the beginning, but then it's so good that you kind of gobble it up. I mean, you gobble it up, and it's a conscious effort to be present with the fork, be present with the food. But part of that being present with the food is, I like to do a little blessing before we eat, and I like to look at the food and start to bless not only what is on the plate, but bless everybody that has brought this to me. I love it when another person cooks and I bless the cook. Thank you for bringing this wonderful meal to us. And I bless the people at the grocery store who put those fruits and vegetables and everything out on those shelves, and the people who unloaded all that food from the trucks into the grocery store. Thich Nhat Hanh, who I've studied with quite a bit, talks about mindful eating. And when I would do retreats with him, he taught me this, was to not only then look at all the people in the grocery store, but all the people who are harvesting the food for us in the fields of California. You drive up 5 and you see the bread basket. It really is a bread basket because you see people working very hard and sweating in the fields. I thank them because they are doing work that I can't do, harvesting in the heat. But then I go even further to thank the earth, the very earth that provides, Mother Earth provides us this nourishment. The rain, the sun, The night is important for the harvest of our food. And there's a whole cycle. It's a whole cycle because we eat and then we have our trash that can be recycled. My husband recycles all of our organic waste into a garden, and it's so It's so kind of weird, actually, because here he goes off the other night with leftover popcorn and mixes it in with eggshells and garbage off the table into this garden he has, and out come tomatoes. I mean, how is that possible? But this is what our Mother Earth does for us. So, of course, I don't have all that in the blessing, but I'm always aware that it's not just me eating a mouthful of food. There is a whole symphony of people that are producing this food for me, and I'm grateful to every single one of them.
So what I'm hearing you say is that you're really connecting with the oneness that we experience as a collective consciousness in terms of the oneness that we have with the nature around us, how Mother Earth feeds us and nourishes us every day, and just kind of pausing into that moment of, it's almost a moment of spiritual oneness. And that takes us away from the impulsivity of the desire, and that we find at a very kind of primal level of like, oh my gosh, I'm having a feeling, I need to eat. That satiable kind of oral fixation almost sometimes of having to put something in our mouth to create a sense of comfort and ease. And it goes back to actually feeding from our mother's breast, from like, having that comfort of having that connection with nourishment and in our mouth at the same time.
And I went through a period, this was some years ago, when I was learning about how much I was using food as comfort. My invitation to the audience, if you seem to use food as comfort, is to pause just for that few seconds. We talk about that few second pause. Put your hand on your heart and ask yourself, what am I needing right now? Am I needing food, or am I needing to be kind and gentle with myself because it's been a hard day today and we're all under a lot of stress regarding what's happening in the world and in our lives, in our families, in the economy? I mean, there's so much. What am just that 2 seconds, hand on heart, what am I needing right now? Do I need a kind word from a friend? Maybe I want to make a phone call rather than eat this piece of cake that's been sitting in the refrigerator just calling to me. Maybe I don't want to put those nuts in my mouth.
And I just want to back up a little bit because I made an assumption that we understand that sometimes we use food as comfort. A lot of people don't even understand that we are using food as comfort. Like, we have to back up a little bit and recognize, how often am I eating? And then being aware of when I'm eating, what times am I eating at? Why am I eating? And that's what Georgiana is saying, what is it that I need? Because if the why is not there, why am I eating at this moment? Then we aren't really understanding the idea of food is being used as comfort. And comfort for what? Right now, comfort for boredom, comfort for fear, comfort for anxiety, comfort for whatever other feelings that we might be, comfort for a lack of activity in our life currently.
Absolutely.
My level of activity has dropped significantly. I talked about that last time when I realized I was sitting for 8 hours straight. And so also the hormonal activity that's happening in the background that might signal to the hypothalamus or whatever that you might be hungry, you're not. So there's kind of like a miscommunication in the brain of sorts that happens in the background that we're not aware of. So first acknowledging, when am I eating? And then going to what Georgiana said, why am I eating this, in terms of what is it that I currently need right now in my life?
Right. Absolutely. That was wonderful. You just covered a lot of material in terms of comfort and why. And that takes a few seconds. It doesn't take a long time. It takes a few seconds between you and that mouthful of food to recognize, is this comfort? To become aware, why am I eating this? Am I hungry? Didn't I just have something? Just to ask a few questions of yourself, what do I really need? Asking, acknowledging first, just like you said, I like that, acknowledging first, you know, I'm going to eat something again. Maybe I don't need two breakfasts today, which sometimes I have two breakfasts in a day. I mean, but maybe some days I don't need two breakfasts.
We start grazing. I'm going to be grazing.
Oh, I love this two breakfasts. My dear little friends that I love are 8, 10, and 12, and their mom has two breakfasts for them, but they eat like birds. You know, they're 8, 10, and 12. They hardly eat at all. So when they eat their first breakfast, they're eating like three mouthfuls, and she knows, and she just gives them a little bit of food, and they eat their little bit of food. But then a couple hours later, they have their second breakfast. And I thought, I like second breakfast. Once I can have some, you know, some bread and cheese, and then my second breakfast can be some eggs. Yeah. Well, maybe I have to use my own teaching and say, hey, are we hungry here?
Yeah, yeah.
And be kind. And I want to be soft on this too. I think it's really important that if you do eat, like throughout the whole day, because you're being comforted by food, that you don't go back and then start beating yourself up for everything you've eaten. We always want to develop that self-compassion that we talked about a while ago. We want to be soft. This is my word. My word for myself today was soften up.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Yeah,
I love that word. I need that word in my life.
Yes.
Soften up. I love that.
Yeah.
You know, we talked a little bit about food as nourishment. Mm-hmm. Can we explore the idea of food as non-harming, as a non-harming principle in mindfulness? Mm-hmm. In terms of not necessarily going into being a vegan or vegetarian, but non-harming of self. Mm-hmm. It's tied to what you're talking about. I'm not going to harm. It's a non-harming of self. I'm not going to punish myself if I had a piece of, I actually had this wonderful mango tart mm-hmm. yesterday with a little bit mm-hmm. of lime sorbet and mm-hmm. and this other sorbet. It was just absolutely delicious. And then I was thinking, oh, darn it, I shouldn't have eaten those carbs. So the idea mm-hmm. of non-harming myself mentally, but mm-hmm. also physically, non-harming myself physically by eating the wrong things.
Mm-hmm. Or non-harming yourself physically by eating so much it's not comfortable.
Right.
And people in the audience may have that experience of eating too much and not feeling comfortable with that too full of feeling, which then the two things have to happen. You be soft with that, and you use it to be curious about what it is that I was doing when I was eating so much. Was it out of habit? Was it autopilot? Was it comfort? Was it boredom? Was it loneliness? Loneliness can be a big one too. We eat out of loneliness. Especially now when some people are alone in their houses without families and without pets.
Mm-hmm. I'm also wondering too about the idea of using a journal, about mm-hmm. kind of like having a little journal in place that shows, when I ate this, this is what happened. When mm-hmm. I drank this, this is what happened. Mm-hmm. Like sometimes when I have trouble sleeping, mm-hmm. I go back in my mind and I think, when was the last time I had an espresso? Or mm-hmm. what kind of tea did I drink this mm-hmm. afternoon?
Absolutely.
Or did I have like a glass of wine that's keeping me up. I thought those were supposed to help me sleep, you know? So
Right.
like having a little journal or notes, mental notes for yourself or on your phone even, where you can leave notes to yourself so that you become aware of yourself and your activity.
Yeah, we're moving towards becoming, living a mindful life, and living a mindful life is developing awareness about who we are, what motivates us, what makes us feel healthy, what makes us feel joyful. My healthy body makes me feel joyful. Talking to you makes me feel happy. And I'd like to start maybe a wrap up of today, because we covered a lot again. And this is a topic we might visit over and over again. I want to mention right now something. We have developed a Facebook page called Better Now, Living Mindfully. And you are invited to go to the page and make a comment. This podcast will be available in a day, probably, and we'll put it up on our Facebook page. But that is a good place to comment, or any of the other platforms that you're listening to this podcast on.
Yes, I just want to second that and just invite everyone to join our community. You know, we are living in a much more lonelier life, and the importance of connection is so vital to our work in living mindfully and living joyfully. And sometimes we might lose track of friends that you normally see at work because you're not at work with them anymore. But there's so much possibility in joining new friends that you've never met on our Facebook page or our Apple podcast or whatever you need or want. We're here for you. Anything else that you wanted to say, Georgiana, before we wrap things up?
No, I think the wrap up is probably next, because we covered some main things around food as comfort, to become aware of the times and the why. First, acknowledging it. Is it because we're needing more activity and we're in the house and we're not able to do that as much as we did? Is it because we're bored? To develop that awareness.
And then you also mentioned being present in the grocery store and like really kind of taking delight in the things that you're eating by looking at them and smelling them.
Yes, recognizing the beauty and the abundance, giving that we go to gratitude there, and also recognizing that food is one of our biggest collective conscious communities. Hundreds of people go into providing that yummy mango tart that you had. Hundreds, maybe 1,000 people. I mean, just recognizing that there's a oneness in everything that we eat.
That's beautiful. I just want to thank everyone for being with us today. It is an honor to be with you and to share the ideas that Georgiana and I have as we come across life. Hopefully ideas that might share in your own perspectives of life. And with that, I want to say thank you for listening. Thank you just so much, Georgiana, for being with us today.
And I hope you all join us again. I know, Ellie, that I feel better now because we talked, and I'm hoping the audience feels better now.
Me too. Thank you, everyone, for being with us. Have a beautiful day. Bye now.
Bye-bye.